This paper kind of broadly looks at protest which has erupted in Hyderabad Central University after Rohit Vemmala's suicide. So I'm not going to kind of go into the details of how the events kind of unraveled, but I'm going to focus very much on one of the song and the analysis of that song. This paper is an attempt to analyze the complex networks of evolution of the aesthetics of contemporary Dalit student protests. This I intend to do by analyzing the song which was produced as Dalit protests in HCU during Justice for Rohit movement in the year 2016. As part of the ongoing protests, students came up with wide range of artistic interventions and artifacts including posters, graffiti, installations, sculptures, street performance, to name some of them. However, in the scope of this paper, I'm not looking at all the artistic interventions, but I'm specifically looking at the song Chikatlo Venelavai, which roughly translates as Moonlight in the Darkness, which was written by Devaya, a Dalit research scholar from Telugu department in HCU. The song emerged as a popular song produced by the student community and was regularly performed in the protest space after Rohit's death, and also during the death and the birth ceremonies of Rohit in front of not just the student community, but also for those who had come to lend their support for the movement. The song was also widely circulated on social networking sites by the students as well as the non-students who were lending support to the movement. There were many songs which were produced during and popularized during Justice for Rohit protests, but Chikatlo Venelavai captures many of the elements of the aesthetics of Dalit protests and offers a rich performance element for analysis. The song reuses earlier aspects and elements of Dalit iconography that reappear in this contemporary song, linking it to the development of specifically Dalit iconography. The song adapts this tradition of Dalit iconography within the context of contemporary Dalit student protests and creates new artifacts and iconography which is evolving from the contemporary context. Although the song is a new artifact produced during the HCU Dalit student protests, it is not devoid of the influence of the past Dalit protest culture and protest culture at large. Through close analysis, we can locate the song both in the regional context of contemporary Dalit culture and trace its connections and references to national political concerns and global political culture and protest culture in particular. Chikatlo Venelavai is using it as synecdoche, meaning a part of a Dalit protest like this song is made to stand as a symbolic representation of the whole society. Korsho further argues, in this version of cultural economy, synecdochic spectacle of the protest challenges a system of authority in its own terms, particularly in the rituals, ceremonies, and reproduction throughout, and the reproduction of these things throughout the media. Justice for Rohit movement was largely covered by the mainstream media, not just within India, but also internationally. Due to the wide circulation of the protest in the mainstream media and the coverage by the alternative media as well, the ruling government was forced to debate the student unrest, not just in HCU, but also across India, particularly the JNU agitations which are happened as well. Kershaw further argues, in late capitalist multi-party democracies produce societies in which performance is central to social political process, producing a performative society. In such a society, the performative becomes a powerful weapon of political conflict, and the aesthetics of performance are relevant to the analysis of politics. Expanding from Kershaw, the protests at HCU and the artifacts such as the song in the context of the protests challenged the authority and its symbolic representation on its own terms through the aesthetic decisions made by the author of the song. Analyzing the song will show how performative in this case the song can be understood as a place where politics manifests and operates. To understand how politics is manifested in the song and how its operation is revealed, I will unpack each verse and the symbolic meaning the author of the song is making through the lyrics of the song. This is a rough translation which I have done it myself. Will you be the moonlight in the darkness, Vemula Rohit? Will you show a way, Vemula Rohit? The song begins and the song ends with calling, seeking, and remembering Rohit. Devia is asking Rohit to lead the students, and doing so is stating that Rohit is more aware or enlightened than they are. In acknowledging Rohit as more enlightened and aware, Devia is transforming Rohit into a hero, a leader, and as an icon. Devia draws from the popular Dalit history, which Badri Narayana coined as mytho history. For Narayana, Dalit mytho history weaves the Dalit past with the Dalit present to envision a future against an oppressive present. Dalit mytho history written by Dalits is a subversive act of reinventing their own histories to demarginalize themselves and become part of mainstream contemporary life. This Narayana claims occurs in the forms of booklets, songs, poetry, biographies, and autobiographies which are sold in the meeting places of the Dalits. Narayana further argues that the histories written by Dalit are figurative, embellished with stories of their popular folk heroes and lower caste characters of Brahmanical religious texts who had suffered injustice due to their low caste birth. The song which Devayar has written takes a biographical take on Rohit by symbolically positioning the accused perpetrators of Rohit's suicide, like Bandaru Dattatreya, the state labor minister then, and Smriti Irani, another accused in Rohit's suicide, then as the dominant caste characters from the Hindu mythology. Devayar further equates Rohit as a lower caste character of the Brahmanical religious texts who suffered injustice in narrating Rohit's story. In the next stanza, Devayar says, "This is Bandaru Dattatreya's Vamana image. BJP's ideology seeks oblation of people. You were sacrificed like Bali Chakravarti Vemula Rohit. You were deceived, Vemula Rohit." Devayar equates Bandaru Dattatreya with Vamana, an incarnation of Hindu god Vishnu. Please forgive me for those of you who already know the myth, but I'm just going to briefly go through it. Prahlada's grandson Mahabali defeated the Devas in a battle and conquered the three worlds. Not able to come to terms with their defeat, the Devas asked Vishnu for the help to defeat Mahabali, who is known as a demon god. Mahabali, to mark his victory, wanted to perform yajna and declared he will grant any wishes during the yajna. Vishnu appeared as a dwarf boy Vamana and asked Mahabali write over a piece of land that measures three paces. As Mahabali agrees, Vamana becomes massive, covering Mahabali's kingdom in two paces. To keep his word, Mahabali offers his head to Vamana, which sends Mahabali to Patala or Netherland. Bandaru Dattatreya wrote a letter to MHRD Minister Smriti Irani asking her to intrude in the situation at HCU. He writes, "Hyderabad Central University has become a den of casteist, extremist and anti-national politics." This could be visualized from the fact that when Vyakub Menon was hanged and Dominant Students Union, that is Ambedkar Student Association, has held protest against the execution. MHRD Minister under Smriti Irani directly wrote four letters to Vice Chancellor of the University referring to the comments made by Bandaru Dattatreya from 3rd September 2015 to 19th September 2015. The students of HCU claim that the suspension of five Dalit scholars was followed after the intervention from the ministry, which eventually led to the suicide of Rohit Vemula. The song which Devayar has written produces an especially rich exchange between the symbolic action of equating Dattatreya with Vamana and socio-political reality of Dalits. The symbolic action of equating Dattatreya is performative as well as constantly defies closure, leaving a possibility of reinterpretation and change. Devayar uses existing interpretation of the Hindu mythological narratives from the broader Dalit protest culture in interpreting Justice for Rohit movement. Moreover, the performative strategies of the protest as well as the song is shaped keeping the onlookers or the audience in consideration. Devayar is very aware of the potential of the performative symbolic meaning the action of equating Dattatreya with Vamana has on the broader Dalit political discourse. Expanding on from Kershaw, in discussing protest events, we are almost always dealing with mediation of those events rather than events themselves. This song, when first performed in HCU, was uploaded live by the media cell established by the students of Mass Communication Department in the university. Devayar is aware of the mediation of the event of the performance of the song and the symbolic meaning which will be attributed to the song by the onlookers or the audience, not just within the protest space, but much beyond through social networking sites. In the next paragraph, Devayar writes, "Since Manu Smriti Irani is woman, we thought she will have heart filled with love and affection. Instead, shower stepmotherly love on a Dalit child, Manu Smriti Irani. Do you know the pain in childbirth, Manu Smriti Irani?" Devayar refers to Smriti Irani as Manu Smriti Irani. Manusmriti is a Veda written by Manu, as you all know, which divides Dalits on the basis of caste. And for Devayar, Manusmriti becomes a symbolic performative action for the in which he tries to equate Smriti Irani to Manusmriti as they rhyme. It is also popular. There are several memes also which has come out as naming Smriti Irani as Manusmriti Irani, and several contemporary leaders have, like Kanhaiya Kumar and Jignesh Vevani, has constantly referred to Smriti Irani as Manusmriti Irani. He plays with the popular cultural idioms as metaphors in means to address an intervention in the functioning of the university on a specific level. At the same time, also attacking the Hindu right-wing nationalist ideology. The speech delivered by Smriti Irani in the parliament after the protest was carefully scripted through the aforementioned homogenized understanding of nation. According to Karen Gabriel, the body national is a female body, and it is fertile maternal body, one that creates and recreates the citizen subjects of the nation. She further argues that gendering and sexualization of nation in political and religious representation is constructed around motherhood, family, gender, sexuality, and kingship, thereby building an implicit emotional and mythical relationship between the nation mother and her counterpart, the universalized citizen male, reinforcing the patriarchal. Karen Gabriel further argues that citizen's man primary duty is to protect his motherland, mother female. The idea of purity and to protect the lineage gives the citizen man authority on her body. To keep the body of the woman pure, citizen man fights for a male-centric social system to generate patriotism. It is directed towards the love of the country and the pride of its culture, kingship, nature, nation, and state, which is territorially defined. Smriti Irani constantly called herself as mother when discussing Rohit's issue in the parliament. As you all know, she's a television actor turned politician who did a leading role in the family soap Kyunki Saas Bhi Kabhi Bahu Thi. Smriti Irani's performance in the parliament was addressed not just to the people within the parliamentary space, but much beyond, to the mediation of the event through the lens of the camera, where she knew will reach out to the citizen subjects. The appeal of the mother nation to her citizen subject, who will readily come for her aid to protect mother nation against the traitors or anti-nationals, students. She constantly referred herself as Ma Mother Nation, and referring to Rohit and rest of the students as bacche, children, citizens with double edge. Her performance transgressed at one hand calling the protesting students as children, and on the other hand proving them as traitors. She scripted her performance in such a way that her on-screen role play as a conventional daughter-in-law, a good mother and mother, and her off-screen role play merged well to render the rhetoric ethos of family, state, and nation. She also claimed that protests at HCO are not Dalit protests, and calling it a Dalit protest is to politicize the death of a child, Rohit. The mediation of the event, the performative considerations, as well as the aesthetic decisions made in the performance is not just used by the protesting Dalit students, but also by the Indian national politicians. The aesthetic decisions Smriti Irani made in equating herself as Mother Nation and thereby positioning the students as traitors comes from popular Brahminical interpretation of nation as dominant caste, which Devaya attacks through mytho history by comparing the minister to Manu. The next paragraph, in which he says, "Saffron color killed you out of venom. To erase the blue color, they poured water. That blue color in water bloomed to be a Bodhi tree, Vemula Rohit. Will you provide shade, Vemula Rohit?" Saffron is the party color of BJP. These are some of the Google images. All of them, ABVP, Bajrang Dal, RSS, BJP, all of them have orange or saffron as the party color. By referring to erasing the blue color, Devaya is trying to refer to the whitewashed walls in HCU after the protests. The most prominent color which emerged during the protest is blue. The students also painted the walls and hang blue flags in and around Velivada, which is a space where Rohit Vemula and four other scholars had occupied, a public space in university, and renamed it Velivada, which means Dalit ghetto, and also had banners in blue color. After the protest ended, the university administration tried to dismantle Velivada, which they have successfully done recently in January, by whitewashing the walls, removing the posters, and gave notice stating students can no longer gather in Velivada. Students claim that the administration move to whitewash the space is to erase the memory of the protest. They further state that it is also to remove or erase the memory of Rohit and several other students' suicide on campus, which went unnoticed. Devia further writes, to erase blue color, they poured water. But the blue color mixed in water bloomed as Bodhi tree. Blue is the color of Dalit movement in India. It is not very clear since when blue became the symbol of Dalit movement. There are several interpretations to it, and one of it being, under the sky everybody is equal, therefore blue is the color of Dalit movement. And one of the other interpretation is being that Ambedkar is known to have introduced his party flag as Independent Labour Party with blue Mahar flag. The other interpretation being Ambedkar always wore three-piece blue suit, and this has been a major inspiration for Dalit movements. Ilaya also states that Ambedkar studied in America, where blue represents democracy, republicanism and equality, and all these ideas were closer to Ambedkar, therefore probably blue then became the color of Dalit movement. The significance of blue color is what Devia is trying to articulate within the context of contemporary Dalit student protests, but also the significance of color from a broader Dalit political discourse. In referring to blue color blooming as Bodhi tree, he points out to the relationship between Buddhism and Dalits. The fig tree under which Buddha reached enlightenment became known as Bodhi tree, which is represented in Buddhist iconography. The Bodhi tree in the context of the Dalit student protest is statue of Rohit Vemula, which was installed during the protest after his death. This statue of Rohit was made by the students, couple of students from finance, but particularly Anil Xavier from finance department of the university. Devia further writes in the song that Bodhi tree, Rohit statue, will offer shade for the protests. Devia, in comparing Rohit statue with Bodhi tree, is claiming Rohit as an enlightened person like Buddha. He is also referring to relationship which with Dalits have with Buddhism. Ambedkar on 14th October 1956 took his Buddhist Diksha amongst half a million of his followers. Since then, millions of Dalits have converted, denouncing Hinduism, which binds them within the caste structure. Gary Michael Tartiko, in the book Dalit Art and Visual Imagery, argues that Ambedkar statue have a visible iconographic imagery where he is represented as an enlightened man in his blue suit with a pen in his pocket and an Indian constitution in the other hand. Devia, in the beginning of the song and in the end of the song, is clearly stating Rohit as enlightened. Nicola Jual argues that there's a similarity in the iconographic representation of Buddha, Rohit, the way the paintings have been done, and Ambedkar, but I'm not getting into the detail of it at the moment. Nicholas Jual argues that for Dalits, the Dalit symbols like that of Ambedkar appeal at a private level. This appeal at the private level reflects the internalization of political imaginary. This contradicts the strict boundary between the private and public, personal and political. When the university tried to dismantle the statue of Rohit and tried to whitewash the blue color in Veliwada, the students reinstalled the statue and repainted the walls with blue color. This shows that the symbols like the blue color and Rohit statue is internalization of political imaginary. The Ambedkar Memorial Shrine in Dadar, Mumbai is called as Stupa, taking on from ancient India. Rohit Vemula statue at Veliwada is also called as Rohit Smaraka Stupa. This highlights the intricate relationship with Dalits have with Buddhism on one level, and on the other, how its influence are seen not just in the earlier Dalit movements, but also in the contemporary Dalit student protests. Sorry. Devia is not just drawing from the complex history from which Dalits are creating, inventing visual, oral and performance iconography, but also synthesizing them with the contemporary context, inventing new heroes. In visualizing and articulating Rohit as enlightened contemporary Dalit hero, Devia transforms Rohit into a contemporary Dalit icon from drawing from earlier Dalit iconography and Dalit mytho history. There are several other interpretations of how Rohit becomes a Dalit icon. There are posters, graffiti, street performances of the letter, which sort of makes him into a Dalit icon. There's the language which Devaya used is not to write the song is a simple and is not a Sanskritized language. However, Devaya is a student of Telugu department in HCU, and he comes from Telangana region. But the language in which Devaya writes this song has an influence of coastal Andhra Telugu dialect. And the other interesting thing where personal and political sort of comes together is Devaya also attempted suicide in the university because he was not given admission in the MPhil and the PhD program, though he procured JRF. And when I asked him why he chose to write a song, because he's not a very politically active, in the sense that he's not part of a political organization in the campus, but has been kind of active during Rohit Vimla's movement. When asked why did he write, then he said that it kind of stuck a personal chord with him when he read Rohit's last letter. But Devaya, the language in which Devaya writes has a coastal Andhra influence because the standardized Telugu language is, which is taught, which is there in All India Radio or Doordarshan, is from the coastal Andhra region. And his academics and his training in the Telugu department is probably sort of influencing his choice of usage of words or languages. Kancha Illaya argues that the language that Dalits use is flexible and alert grammar designed for production-based communication. Though Devaya uses production-based language, which is very simple to sort of understand, but the language shows the influence of coastal Andhra. I'm paraphrasing Badri Narayana here. Dalit writers like Devaya are more concerned about reaching out to people in simple communicable language, which shows their feelings, anger and dissent against the caste structure, than about literary standards. Coming to the composition of the song, Devaya has written, has an influence of the folk tunes. The usage of these folk songs for political mobilization... I have one page. The influence of... usage of folk for political mobilization in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana can be traced back to Telangana armed struggle with Prajanatya Mandali and particularly with Naxalite movement with Jananatya Mandali, where Gaddar has also been a part of, which was connected to Indian People Theatre troupe. And Prajanatya Mandali and Jananatya Mandali's performance aesthetics are very much embedded within the regional folk forms, such as Ogukata, Burakata, Harikata. And all these forms are song and dance and storytelling formats. Devaya's father is also a folk artist. And while having an interview with him, he did say that, you know, he kind of listened to these songs as he grew up. And so it came naturally to him to compose the song in that format. He interestingly draws the aesthetic from his own personal background as well as from the protest culture in writing, composing and singing the song. The instrument used by Devaya to support the song is dappu, a percussion instrument used by Madiga subcaste within Dalit community, and which is also usually accompanied in the Chindu dance. Kumar in his blog writes this, I'm not going to read it out because we are running out of time. Devaya used dappu as not just to accompany the song but also as a form of cultural resistance. And dappu has also been a symbol of Madiga Dandora movement. This song on YouTube is uploaded on Dalit Camera Channel, and this Dalit Camera Channel has been active since 2014, which documents discrimination on Dalits and has also interviewed several Dalit activists. And the link to the song says #DalitLivesMatter. The hashtag Dalit Lives Matter was a Twitter feed which was started during the protest at HCU, and the media, which was set forth by the media cell headed by the mass communication students, and the protesting students at HCU are drawing from the hashtag Black Lives Matter, which started in the year 2013 by African American community after killing of the African American teen. On one hand, Devaya draws from the Dalit mytho history, folk forms, and on the other hand, in circulation, the protest also draws from global political culture. The analysis of the song shows that the aesthetics and the politics are intertwined and cannot be separated from each other. The analysis shows that the complex networks from which protests draw, not just aesthetically, but also politically from each other, without compromising on the specificity of the context. The past artifacts, like the blue color, installing statues, biographies, songs, reappear in hybrid form in the contemporary protest, positioning itself not just within the contemporary and past Dalit protest culture, but also protest culture at large. The song is a biographical take on Rohit and the circumstances which led to his suicide. And Devaya himself positions himself within the context of the movement in writing the song. His song, therefore, is not just biography of Rohit, but also becomes a symbol of Dalit lives, not just within the university, but through their circulation as a spectacle, synecdochic spectacle. This shows that the aesthetic is always and inextricably intertwined with the social, cultural, and the political of not just the immediate context, but also with the regional and the national global context. Thank you.
Thank you, Sumi, for that very warm introduction. Thank you guys for bringing me here. Unlike the speakers y'all have heard the whole day, I'm going to be missing most of the important jargon. I come from an artistic space, so most of what I'm sharing with you all today is my lived experiences as an artist traversing through different worlds, urban and rural, and within the urban world, how many different worlds, and within the rural world, what different worlds have I come across. And also the assertion and desertion, and also understanding my gender and caste and language, the language politics through my work. So a little bit of background. I'm an actor, so you might hear a lot of me, I through this, but please forgive me for that. So my family background is my dad and mom are both Madigas. My dad was a bureaucrat. He was an IAS officer for the longest time. He retired 2 years after I got married, 10 years ago. But having said that, we were the only family within our larger family circle to be in the city and live an upper middle class life. I went to a convent school. My dad always said, it's going to be different for you because you're going to be in a convent school. People won't ask you what your caste is, and that identity is not going to be evident. So convent, yeah. So I grew up in a convent. I also went to a convent school and a convent college. And after that, I went to masters to do my, I went to Australia to do my masters in filmmaking. And when I came back, I was hit with new sense of objectivity. I wanted to be out in the field, and I wanted to be closer to my grandmother's side of the family than my parents' side of the family, which was based in the city. So a little bit about my grandmom. I grew up with my grandmom, who is from Bidar. Any of you all know where Bidar is? The northmost. Yeah, of course. So we have in Bidar, you have this place called Raipali. She came from a village, Raipali, which was very close to the borders. So she spoke half Kannada, half Marathi. She had learned Kannada because she had gotten married into a Kannada family. So the language politics was always very strange in our house. So if I went towards my maternal mom's side, it would go into Kannada and Telugu. If I went into my paternal mom's side, it would go into Marathi and Hindi. So she would sing us these songs, and most often my vocation in music, I've never studied to be a musician or a vocalist. I learned from my grandmom. My grandmom's my biggest mentor. So the songs that she would sing would be, okay, I'll sing you one. It goes like this. Bandara bara hela sundara suganaka rangata idada ye guru raya rangamalo me pani kyu aaya. It would start off saying, come. Everybody who wants to come for this good occasion, come. Everybody who wants, who knows this is a good shagun ka moment, come. And she says that that is in Kannada, and then it suddenly bursts into, but this is wonderful, God, but ranga malo me pani kyu aaya? Why did it rain today? And quite often there were these songs which mixed two languages, mixed two dialects. She was an agricultural laborer, and she would put her khache up and turn it into shorts, and showing legs was not a big deal to her. So when I wore something short, she'd be like, mag ear saple hakbad, as in don't wear a skirt which will ride up your bum. Wear something that's like shorts, yeah, that kind of covers the crotch area, and that's fine. But my mom had issues with short clothes because her background, her mother was a teacher, and she was prim and proper, and she's like, oh my goodness, she's wearing short clothes. That would be the concern. So like this, there was always these two worlds that were mitigating, and I was moderating as to what I'm going to be and where. With that in mind, oh yeah, I have to tell you a nice story. My grandmom and I are sitting and watching Star movies one day. Not intentionally, she wanted to watch Udaya, but I switched the channel and Speed was playing. Keanu Reeves and Sandra Bullock? Anybody? Yeah. So this film is playing and the train is about to crash and both actor and actress, they're going to die. And they start making out and they start kissing each other and me and my sister start fidgeting with the remote. We're like, oh my goodness, my grandmother's watching, I'm feeling very nervous. I'm trying to change the channel, I'm looking elsewhere. And my grandmom's literally propped up at the edge of a seat and she's staring at the screen, intently. And then we were like, what's up with her? And she looks at us and she says, Mari ak tin lata ve? Why are they eating each other's faces? Over the next few days, I was hit with a series of epiphanies, you can say. She had never made out with my grandfather. Because the houses in the village, Dalit houses, don't allow that. You don't have that kind of space. You're not in a wade. Wade giddara, like if you're in a house which is a big Brahminical house in the village, you have a compound, you have separate rooms, you have first floor, second floor. But when you have a single room house, you have to wait to get to the field to make out. And you're doing it behind bushes and trees. There is a certain reason why kissing and making out is not seen that way. There was so much about language and caste and how different the worlds that I was traversing through and she had traversed through came right in front of my eyes. It was so evident. Now, after being in Australia, I came back. I was a filmmaker for some time. I made agricultural films for the KSDA and Agricultural University, UAS. And it was a great time because I would just get into my car, I would take my two boys, one camera operator, one assistant, the kid, and we'd just drive off. And we'd live in the farmer's house, we'd record, we'd make, I made films on social justice, women's rights, anything that would get me out of the city, I would do it. And something I was doing that unconsciously what I was doing is I was asserting my urban identity on the people I was documenting. I would go in there without a bindi, looking like this, researcher type, messy hair, not combed. And I would walk into their house and I didn't realize I was carrying the power. The camera gave me power, the car that I drove gave me power. And what I was looking at it as is this romantic idea of let's go out and be in the field and let's enjoy this nature. And that over time broke for me. It had to, my goodness, thank God. So the last job I had before I started this company was in Indian Ostrom. I moved to Pondi. I was also a part of a Rangashankara theatre here. And when you look at theatre in proscenium spaces, and you go back to Mudbi and you see Yellamma Nata, it's Dasara and they're doing a play on Yellamma. And when you see that play and when you see the play in Rangashankara, there are yet a ton of questions that come to your head. What does this proscenium mean? Where does it come from? And why have we adapted it? Why do people, and when small time theatre personalities like me are looking for audience, it's so difficult to get people to get them to pay and turn up. Why? Because we come from a culture where you turned up at the festival, you turned up at the jatre, and there was your entertainment. We all sang, we all danced. If natka happened, there was no fourth wall to that natak. There was no, you are the audience. This distance wasn't there, basically. So I left that job because I had some politics that was brewing, and also I was devising of my family deity Yellamma for a Tamil play, and it created a lot of confusion. So I said, I have to go back. I have to go back to my Yellamma. I have to go back to my Madhiga roots that have stayed kind of dormant inside me because of the urbanization, because of the urban setup, because of convent, because of everything. Like to my Anglo-Indian friends, I was just Hindu like everybody else. And so I was like, yeah, I'm Hindu. But my dad is a hardcore Ambedkarite, and slowly and steadily he kind of said, yeah, we have to build pride in who we are. And that's something that I took from what he gave me. So what do we do as UFP? Sumi, time? So when I started UFP, how it started. So my partner, Aditya Kotukota, he was working for one of the accounting big fours. And I used to see him only during the weekends. We were married, but we didn't really get that much time. And when he quit that job, he had this love for travel. He wanted to go out. And I quit my job in Pondicherry. We came back and we started traveling. It was a good 1 year of just going in different directions in Karnataka, meeting academicians, meeting archivists, meeting folk artists, just refiguring out what that region meant, the North Karnataka region, all the way from Belgaum to Bidar. I associated so strongly with it, I could speak the language, I could curse just as well as my grandmother, and still somewhere I felt alienated in that space. So we started traveling, and again, the same thing, as a couple, we're not a conventional couple from a small town or a rural space. So we being a contemporary couple, landing up in a space like that was asserting something else. This, we are a modern couple. We hang out like this. My husband holds my hand. He doesn't feel bad. We walk together and he doesn't walk in front of me. All of these things these women would ask me. Like they're standing right next, he's standing right next to you, such a sweet husband. I'm like, no, not really, I mean. So our beginnings were like this, from two different worlds, figuring out what kind of life we wanted. And if we didn't want to live in Bangalore, which was the issue for some time, where would we live and what community would accept us as someone, not like a zamindar to go there and have a farmhouse and get some farmers, not that, but actually live in a community, what would that mean? So when we started, it was about documenting and researching performative folk forms. And not just folk forms in the sense of performance forms, but you're also looking at rituals, and you're also looking at ritual performance. So from a Bhutakola to a Yellamanata to Chowdiki Pada to Mante Swami Pada, there are over 200 forms, we were told, in Karnataka. And so Adi and I, Aditya, my partner and myself, we sat down and made a small list, and we knew 20 forms. And we're like, okay, so it's a lifetime project just to find out what the rest of them are out of the 200. If we've done 1 year of travel and we've found 20 out of the 200, then there's a lot more travel to do. So we've braced ourselves and we said, we start a company. And again, there is one strange sense of romanticization when we look at the rural and the folk sphere. We are thinking, today we'll have a car, then it'll become a camper van, then we'll have a bigger camper van, and we will travel and we'll make this archive and it'll be beautiful. Doesn't work like that. So we figured out that we needed people from all sorts of fields to kind of come and help us as to how we were looking at this. How were we going to present it? How not to disenfranchise? How to appropriate? How to at least speak on the terms of appropriation? Maybe you might not be able to appropriate to the point. I mean, you still might go wrong, but to keep that conversation open, to keep the community involved with that kind of process. Those are the things that started coming to us when we had Sumi and Asim, who are very generous academicians who dealt with my crass language and said, okay, it's okay, you speak whatever your language, we will figure out what we want to do with the archive. And how, even before we make the archive, we can try and make an archive alive. There are so many archives. If you look at Janapadaloka or Manipal, these guys have 7,000, 8,000 hours of footage. And I found it very difficult to get access to this. And I'm thinking, if I'm an archiver, I'm archiving today, I'm documenting. 20 years after I'm dead, I'm hoping someone has access to the footage I made. I don't want it dying in some wardrobe, because I've traveled for it. I've driven and I've camped under trees and I've sat behind bushes for it. So please, how do we make this accessible was the thing. How do we make an accessible archive? And also, how do we keep that dialogue open? How am I receiving folk? How am I introducing that folk to somebody else? If I'm introducing that folk in the urban, what are the issues that I'm going to go through? Not just in terms of representing the caste, which is inseparable from folk, is what I understood. When you're looking at folk forms, you have to understand which community it comes from. And quite often the stories and the myths that they had to tell had that DNA of their culture within it. You had to go through the story, you had to see the performance, and then it would emerge little by little. Because I'm not an academic, guys. I mean, I'm not looking in that lens. I'm looking in aesthetic terms. What do I see? What are the symbols I see? How is it being played? How this actor doesn't care that he's not worn a blouse, but he's still portraying a woman. Like in Yellamanata, I'll give you an instance. Everyone's sitting down, they're watching a play, and Parshurama is born to Renuka. And the person who plays Renuka is usually a transgender person. So that transgender woman kind of sits down, she spreads her legs, she shoves this doll. You remember those dolls which you they used to open and close their eyes? You remember that doll? Those plastic ones which the head rips off very easily. That one. So that doll, she shoves it under her skirt and she kind of pops it out of her skirt, and that's how Parshurama is born in the play. It's very beautiful. One guy, she calls out to the person on the street, and she's Renuka. She's Renuka Yellamma, she's a goddess, and she's swearing. The play is happening in a temple. Come, you stupid bitch, come give my son a bath. I'm blinded because he has broken my back open and he has come to this world. So the actor who comes in has rushed in because he was smoking a BD and he didn't know his cues. So he comes rushing in and he picks up the baby. Renuka, yena maga hana re, ninu hotti somara santi agirbek. Ready made magu bandada. So, translation, it says, wow, what a stomach, what a womb yours must be. It's like a shopping mall. This baby has come out fully prepared, clothes and eyes and eyelashes and everything. And it was that. Not to see it as something that is unchangeable, but the actor feels that he has the right to go right in, change the myth right there and then, and you accept it. That's magic. And that magic is something that I really got addicted to watching. And I grew up watching it, so I knew the language. But still, even though I was from that region, or I had roots in that region, that language was hard, like in Gigipada. Gigipada is a battle between two teams. They battle about the sexes. So one team sings for men and one team sings for women. And they start off. When it starts off pretty philosophical, naming gods. Manisha andra Shiva iddanga, Henamagal andra Parvati iddanga. It starts off like that. But then it becomes cheeky and then just downright nasty quickly. And it's 6 hours long, so you have 6 hours to get nasty. So the guys were singing for the men. He starts off, kanda kanda rigala banavara torusda ki ni hanta dhoda gariti agi 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 agi. That means, you have shown what a good Sunday is to so many good people. Why would you put up your price? Come, battle it out with me. That took some time to fix. I took some time to figure that out. Kanda kanda rigala bhanavara torusdiki. Are you shown Sunday to many people? I'm wondering what this means. So even the translating of that became a process to go around and ask people, Ajja, what do you think? Ajji, what do you think? And she's like, hey, all these cheeky lines, how do I explain it? That became a reason to interact and a way to keep that alive. Someone would say, hey, you know, like, why would you need it? You're a city girl. Why do you need to know what they're saying? Or the youngsters, I would catch one young boy and I'd be like, just sit next to me and translate, okay? Whenever I hold your hand, that means I didn't get it and you have to explain the last few lines. And he said, like, he had this, how dare you ask me to, there's an EDM party happening in the village, mind you. How dare you ask me to leave that and come for this? This is old school stuff. And that's when I realized I was using words wrong. Like when I was applying and when I was telling people what I was doing, I was using the words preserve, which is so dangerous. I wasn't preserving, I wasn't into preservation at all. I was looking more at the continuity of it or why there is lack of continuity. I was just trying to start a discourse with my work in documenting. And so the words started to change. Continuity, transference. And how do we engage both these? If you say urban and folk, how do we engage both of these rather than the urban goes and extracts from the folk? How do we make it a give and take? Those are the questions I'm asking right now. Of course, the other questions that we had is how do we question this mainstream idea of folk? When people draw from folk, and I know a lot of mainstream artists do this, they will pick up a folk song and they will put a great digital track on it and they will call it their own. It's also that. How do we question that? How do we stop people from doing that if we want to? There's some things that I realized that for me, folk was contemporary. I'm not saying this like a statement. I'm not claiming that this is true, but for me, the way I saw folk forms working in their sphere, in the rural sphere, it felt that it constantly made space for someone to mess with it. It didn't say this is a classical form, it has to be up on a pedestal, don't touch it, then wash your hand and then touch it. It didn't have that. It meant that you go in, you meddle, you mash, you judgeify, you can do all of that stuff. So then the question became, so then the question became, how, if I'm going to draw from this and be inspired by it, how much leeway do I have to stick to the original? Or how much leeway do I take in when I teach someone, do I teach it like a classical form? No, you can't change that note. No, you can't change the beat. You can't do it in jazz. You can't do Yalama song in blues. Am I going to be that person? Who am I to actually say that? So now we've had friends who've come to the park. What I started doing is I started this experiment. It's still going on. It's not an experiment, it's become a class. I sit in Coven Park every morning except Sundays and Mondays to teach these songs for free. The documentation we did, we collected over 16 songs in a year just on Project Yalama, just about Yalama. Jogti songs, Devdasi songs. And we started teaching these songs for free to see that if they're not going to live in the field, maybe they'll live in the city. Maybe people will understand the meaning. Maybe they might not understand all by heart all the lyrics, but they'll still get a meaning, a gist, how the beat is, how the physiology of the voice is, which is one of the key things that I've been working on, to understand that I could have sang Hutti Bande Yellamma Nagi. Do I sing it like that? Or do I sing Hutti Bande Yellamma Nagi Ninna Maduviya Maadi? What is the difference in these two voices, politically speaking, and why I need to do it in one and not the other? Just to summarize, it's about asserting my identity in four different spaces since Urban Folk Project. One, of course, is the rural space, where I feel like quite often I'm denied my Madhaga identity. I remember I went to Radhabai and she recorded some songs, and then I said, I nabi Madhaga idda, even I'm a Madhaga. She's like, hi, niyak Madhaga idda, ni gaudutti illa Brahman trikiyage irubakeni. She said, you must be a gaudutti or a Brahmin girl, and you're just saying that to make me feel better. She took offense, and I took offense too. I was like, that's so sad. Just like how Manjamma, my Jogati Ai, she saw me and she saw my Chowdiki, that's the Devdasi instrument. I brought a new one so I could learn from her. And she said, your Chowdiki is just like you, plain. Urban Folk Project has many questions. We're about a year old and we're in this limbo of what to do, where, how to represent, how to transfer, and we have a set called Yalama and Other Stories that has done 40 shows now. And I'm not proud of this, but we've been called to very fancy spaces, like festivals in Bombay where the goodie bags are big. You know what I'm saying? Like you dig in and it's deep. You're looking at Kochi Biennale where you have the art elite, the art world there, and you're just like, oh, we're the folk people. And you already feel like that itself is making you feel like you're getting the dressing room right at the end, not the one in front. And also the other space is the new space for me, is the rural elite space. And I really underestimated the power of this space over me. But when I went to Anina Samora, Tharwad University, I felt it. The fact that I don't speak Kannada as well as them. My English was seen as a disadvantage. It's like she doesn't even speak Kannada. What she's doing is a sham. So yeah, I will be open to questions. My story is quite big. I can go on about my grandmother and her anecdotes, but we'll open for questions. Thank you.
ಇವ್ರ ಮಾಳವಿಕ ಅವರ ಟಾಕ್ ಹೇಗಿತ್ತು ಅಂದರೆ ರೋಹಿತ್ ವೇಮುಲ ಆತ್ಮಹತ್ಯೆ ನಂತರ ನಡೆದಂಥ ಇನ್ಸಿಡೆಂಟ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ಪ್ರತಿಭಟನೆ ಮತ್ತು ದಲಿತ ಸಂಘರ್ಷದ ಚಾರಿತ್ರಿಕ ಇತಿಹಾಸನ ತಗೊಂಡು ಅದರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ದಲಿತ ಸಂಘರ್ಷದ ಪ್ರತಿನಿಧೀಕರಣ ಹೇಗಾಗ್ತಿದೆ, ಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ಚಿತ್ರಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ ಹೇಗಾಗ್ತಿದೆ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಬಣ್ಣದ ಮೂಲಕ ಚಿತ್ರ ಬಣ್ಣ ಈ ಥರ ಕಣ್ಣಿಗೆ ಕಾಣಿಸುವಂಥ ಎಷ್ಟೋ ಸಂಕೇತಗಳು ಹೇಗೆ ಇದರ ಜೊತೆ ಒಂದಕ್ಕೊಂದು ತಾಳೆ ಹೊಂದ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ, ಇದನ್ನ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಕಟ್ಕೊಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಸಂಘರ್ಷಕಾರರು ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರತಿಭಟನಾಕಾರರು, ಇದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು ಅವರು. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಇದನ್ನ ಈ ಪ್ರತಿಭಟನೆನ ಬರೀ ಈ ತಕ್ಷಣದ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತ್ರ ನೋಡದೆ ಇದನ್ನ ಚರಿತ್ರೀಕರಿಸೋದು ಹೇಗೆ, ಹಾಗೆ ಇದರ ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಏನು, ಇದು ಕಟ್ಕೊಡ್ತಿರೋಂಥ ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಏನು, ಇದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದರು. ಸೊ ರೋಹಿತ್ ವೇಮುಲಾನ ಒಂದು ದಲಿತ ವಿಕ್ಟಿಮ್ ಆಗಿ ನೋಡಿದೆ, ಒಂದು ಹೀರೋ ಆಗಿ ಹೇಗೆ ಪದ್ಯಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ, ಹಾಡುಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ, ಮತ್ತು ಮೌಖಿಕ ನಾಟಕಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ ಹೀಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಕಟ್ಕೊಟ್ರು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಒಂದು. ಇನ್ನೊಂದು, ಇದರ ಸುತ್ತ ಸಂಕೇತಗಳು ಹೇಗೆ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಟ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇವೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ನಿಮಗೆ ಬಣ್ಣ ತೋರಿಸಿದ್ರು ಏನೋ ನೀಲಿ ಬಣ್ಣ, ಅದು ಹೇಗೆ ಅಂಬೇಡ್ಕರ್ 3-piece ಬ್ಲೂ ಸೂಟ್ ಏನೋ ಅದರ ಸಂಕೇತ, ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಅಮೇರಿಕನ್ ಪ್ರಜಾಪ್ರಭುತ್ವದ ಸಂಕೇತ ಆಗಿತ್ತು, ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂಬೇಡ್ಕರ್ ಕಟ್ಟಿದ ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಪಕ್ಷದ ಬಣ್ಣವೂ ಸಹ ಅದಾಗಿತ್ತು ಅಂತ, ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಬೌದ್ಧ ಧರ್ಮದ ಏನೋ ರೆಫರೆನ್ಸ್ಗಳಿಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಗೆ ಬಂತು ಅನ್ನೋದು. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಇದು ಪೌರಾಣಿಕ, ಚಾರಿತ್ರಿಕ ಮತ್ತು ಜಾನಪದ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಗಳ ಸಂಕೇತಗಳಿಂದ ಪ್ರೇರಣೆಗೊಂಡು ಹೇಗೆ ಇದು ಈ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿ ರಚಿಸಲ್ಪಟ್ಟಿತು ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ನಿಮಗೆ ಮಾಳವಿಕಾ ಅವರು ಹೇಳಿಕೊಟ್ರು. ಕೊನೆಯದಾಗಿ ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದು ತುಂಬ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಅಂಶ ಏನಂದರೆ, ಈ ಪ್ರತಿಭಟನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ಸಂಘರ್ಷಗಳನ್ನು ತಕ್ಷಣದ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತ್ರ ನೋಡದೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಆ ಪ್ರಾದೇಶಿಕದ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಿಂದ ಆಚೆಗೆ ಜಾಗತಿಕ ಮತ್ತು ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಸಂದರ್ಭಗಳಲ್ಲೂ ಸಹ ಅದಕ್ಕಿರುವಂತಹ ಕನೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಥವಾ ಅದಕ್ಕಿರುವಂಥ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಕೊಂಡಿ ಏನು ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಅರ್ಥ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದು. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಬ್ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ ಲೈವ್ಸ್ ಮ್ಯಾಟರ್ ಅನ್ನೋ ವಿಚಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳಿದರು, ಅಂದರೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಅದು ಒಂದು ರೀತಿಯ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಬೆಸ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಯಾತಕ್ಕೆ ಅಮೇರಿಕನ್ ಬ್ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ ಕಲ್ಚರ್ಗೆ, ಹೇಗೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿಯ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ಗೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿನ ಪ್ರತಿಭಟನೆಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ನಿಮಗೆ ರೆಫರೆನ್ಸಸ್ ದೊರಕ್ತು ಅನ್ನೋದರ ವಿಷಯ. ಸೊ ದಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಹರ್ ಮೇನ್ ಆರ್ಗ್ಯುಮೆಂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಮೈ ಒಪಿನಿಯನ್.
You spoke about the aesthetics of the protest song, and the analysis seemed more literary than the performative dimension of it. So did you also look at not just the meaning of the text itself, but the meanings in the performances, when it was done, in what places, what the repetition of it, what happened around, how did the audience respond to that performance of the song, and like in that sense the larger dimension of meaning making that happens outside language per se.
I wanted to know, since you're doing Nirvana stories, the concerts which you do, the shows which you conduct, what kind of feedback do you get? I wanted to know about that.
Okay. So what the kind of feedback I get in different spaces is different. When we did it in a small village in Ullathatti in Coimbatore, it's a Badaga village, so we did it in Kannada, and the feedback was like, so crazy, you city people, you all are so sweet to do this, like we were doing it for them. But when you do it in the urban elite space, I fear that there is an exoticization, a complete opposite of what I'm trying to do. Like when I land up in a Kochi Biennale or a spoken festival in Bombay, it's a highly corporatized event and you have a lot of money coming in, and you're thinking, am I playing into the same politics that I'm trying to avoid? Like I'm trying to resist this exoticization of, or at least say I don't stand for it. But I feel somewhere when we start performing, you never know when you're playing into it. So one of the feedbacks that I got, I'd like to share. I did a show in JP Nagar, and there's a man who speaks right after my performance. He says, before I finish actually, before I said thank you very much, he said, wait a minute, I'd like to finish. I'd like to voice my opinion. He said, Kannada is great, our literature is amazing. Karanth, Kuempu, all these guys have made the language something else. What you are doing is regressing the language. And then I had to kind of respond to it saying that the language that my grandmom speaks, your literature doesn't represent it. This is the oral tradition that I have to speak in this language and this physiology. I have to be this loud because that's what this form means. Sometimes I get great feedback which makes my heart really warm. One girl came to me once and said, I've always been told that I'm too loud, but you make me feel good about it.
And
When you talk about language, it is also performative. So there's this idea of performative iteration when we say, and then also language creates a certain kind of a dramatic, though it may not be performed dramatically also because it's a song, but it does create a kind of an imagery in your head when you say Vamana and you compare it to Bandara Dattatreya. There's an imagery which comes in, which is what I'm saying is performative in a sense. I mean, if Devaya would have straight away written something like, say, Dattatreya is a bad guy, the impact or the way what it is trying to communicate will not be the same. Because I think, particularly within Dalit aesthetics and Dalit literature, I think there's a lot of emphasis on the imagery and what it is doing than actually the act of doing itself, so much emphasis. And also it was like in the beginning, I think in the paper I did mention that it was performed in Veliwada and also in several other places, in meetings. And also when I mean in the larger PhD context, I think when I'm talking about public space, I'm not limiting it to the actual space, but also extended spaces through social networking sites and what's the kind of articulation which is being developed. This song has been most popular among all the songs which came out during Justice for Rohit movement, I think, which came from the student community particularly. And I think everybody knows this song within the student community by heart, more or less. I think in every protest space, after Rohit's death, and also recently when I attended the marking the death anniversary of Rohit Vemula, even this, it started with singing this song, so it's always sang in almost all the protest spaces. In the sense, the interaction with the audience is what you're saying. Most of the people in the audience know the song by now. As much as I have heard the song being sung in the protest space, everybody knows the lyrics of the song. Almost most of the students have been active kind of people. I mean, HU is a much cosmopolitan space, but people clap most often and then they kind of know the song by heart. And it has been circulated very well, I think. A lot of people remember the lines of it very well. And it is not always sung independently. I mean, it's sung amongst several other songs also. So, I mean, obviously song has a very very important role to play within the protest. Obviously, when it keeps people together, it mobilizes people. But also keeps it alive, the space. And also they have changed the lyrics depending upon the context, a lot of songs. So yeah, it's always song within amongst several other songs. So it's always like it begins with the song, then there is a meeting, and again ends with the song. That sort of a thing. Similar format is sort of followed.
And something about the format of the song is similar to a lot of folk songs. It will have a little geotag at the end to say where it's come from. Yeah, it starts with something personal, which we make up, and then of course there's a verse which gets repeated. So this one is called Chinchori Har. अड़कल मड़कल आगी हुड़ पुताने भट्टा गड़गी वाड़ा युताने अड़कल मड़कल आगी हुड़ पुताने भट्टा गड़गी वाड़ा युताने हुड़ा काड़ी हुट्टा मुरी युताने सुअक्का नारे अड़कल मड़कल आगी हुड़ पुताने There's a soul, there's a person who's just dead, and that soul searches. Adukal madukal arthurutu. Bhatta gadgi, the bhatta, when the pot has to go around the body, he breaks with precision. Then hudukadi hutta muri utare. He picks up grass, he looks for grass, breaks it, and he puts it on the pyre. And then there is suakanare. Two things, when you say su. The breathing is such that you put someone to sleep. You're asking someone to calm down. You're asking that soul to calm down, one. Or when Bisokalhar, when you have these pounding sounds, you have su. The physiology of su itself helps you whack something. It's like how someone asking you to do yoga says, breathe out here. Su is your breathe out. So this is the first verse. Utta siri yala konda, tata gumsa kala konda. Adi tappa ulvi khalvi dane, su akkanare. Kapada, the sari I have worn, he has taken. The blouse I was wearing has been removed. Now, just with one simple tappu, haligi, duff, he is going to beat it and he is going to send me away. So, Akkana. Dhari olu chinchali vasasita na pali Malika junayadiya maadi dane Su akkana re, su akkana re. This is that little geo tagging that I was talking about. Dhari olu chinchali, chinchali king has a little swami who he will, that swami will do the rites for him and he will sing su akkana re for that king. So these are songs which are kind of loosely built, so you can kind of twine it in between. If a friend of yours died, her name and her family and her story can come into the song. So this is Su Akkanare, and there are many songs, of course. There's another song just to give you an idea of how Su is different from a Piso Gana. Chakki Gana. If you hear just the motion of the song, it's for something that's circular. It's supposed to, you can vary the speed of the song depending on how fast your chakki is moving. This speed to this speed. So quite often music was that. It was not really a commodity that we paid and we watched. So most of the songs that my grandma sings have these small bits of knowledge and philosophy. If we had time, I could go on. But there's another song. Quickly, don't look at me like that. I'm looking at you. There is a song called Yen Berki Mavan Magana. It's like this little cheeky song which talks about this girl who ran away from her husband and went running all the way till Dharwad. Sandhi Bindu Aduaga Katala Dagam Karinai Bakchala Dagya Bai Haki Hita Kari Yokon Hota Yen Verki Yen Verki Mavan Magala. She tells this little lies about how she escaped. Patli Garili Se Nikal Gayi. So she took one small little route and she escaped. She landed up in this very dark space where she had to take a shit. A dark black dog came and grabbed her and took her into the wilderness. This sounds like sexual assault when I explain it in English. But it's a really cheeky double meaning song. It's supposed to be like, let's talk about this girl. And funny enough, the whole song is about you've forgotten your whole family. And finally it comes to the guy who's singing the song says kudi bala bek tangi atti swastyara niu vyara dar sigudilla udula ka bangaro ayen vergi. He talks about a girl who's been unfaithful to her husband, took up a rental husband, went to Dharwad, lived moj masti sab kuch, but then he turns around and he says, you want to be friends with your mother-in-law if you have sense. If you want the ancestral gold, you will be friends with your mother-in-law. Who cares about the husband?